Hello, I'm Ahmed Fauzi, and welcome back to the Peace One Day celebration of Peace Day 2016. This is the second segment, or the second program, in a long series of programs we have for you throughout the day. We'll be sharing with you a lot of material on Peace Day, both documentaries and music and interviews. So stay with us. During this segment, we will be screening the first ever Peace One Day feature film. It is 1 hour, 20 minutes long. It's an award-winning feature documentary that's been shown all over the world and won many, many awards. After we see the film, we'll actually be talking to the producers, Oscar-winning John Batzek and Nick Fraser. They'll be with us, and they have two very interesting interviews for you this morning. The film Peace One Day tracks the journey of the creation of a fixed date in the UN calendar, which is now the 21st of September, and how we, well, rather Jeremy Gilley and his team in Peace One Day lobbied very hard to fix the date in the UN calendar and made sure it was a global ceasefire, a day of global ceasefire and non-violence. And that's very, very important, because it ain't just about guns and bullets. It's about violence in the homes, domestic abuse. It's about bullying in the schoolyard. And we'll be talking about all that throughout the day. So sit back and relax, if you have the time to, and enjoy the feature-length documentary Peace One Day. We will be seeing you later with interviews with the producers. Remember to tell your friends about this platform, Peace One Day Facebook page, and all our programs will be up on the Peace One Day YouTube channel. So, we're going to roll the film in a few seconds. Feature-length documentary, Peace One Day. Enjoy.
My name's Jeremy Gilley. I was an actor for many years, taking whatever roles I could. The last job I did was a crazy sci-fi. My character was trying to save the planet. I thought it would be my big break. I heard it was seen in Eastern Europe. Then I started making my own low-budget films, looking for clues to make sense of the world. The more I looked, the more confused I felt.
I want to leave!
When I'd watch TV, it seemed like the world's in such a desperate state. The more violence I saw, the more frustrated I felt about not being able to make a difference. But I really wanted to try. In July 1998, I had the idea. What if there was one day, just 24 hours, when the world stopped killing? I was going to try to create a day of peace and make a documentary about that journey. If I failed, it would make an interesting film about a world unwilling to change. If I succeeded, well, that was almost inconceivable. For a day of peace to be truly global, it would need the backing of the United Nations. I wrote to Sekiran Prendergast, Under-Secretary General for Political Affairs, asking for a meeting to talk about the idea. He invited me to New York. I couldn't believe it. I went in my mate's suit, my granddad's tie, and got a free ticket from British Airways.
In the Foreign Office, the training traditionally has always been, when there's a new idea, what 20 reasons are there why it won't work? Well, I thought, you know, this fellow is either a fool or a visionary. And of course, it's always very difficult to know which of the two. I think the cause is certainly a very good one. Yeah, it may work, and if it does work, it'd be very good.
I found out a day of peace already existed, a United Nations International Day of Peace, established by Costa Rica through a UN resolution in 1981. But nobody I'd spoke to had heard of it. It was supposed to fall on the third Tuesday in September to coincide with the opening of the General Assembly, but rarely did. And it didn't even ask anyone to stop fighting. What I wanted to create was a global day of peace with a fixed calendar date. But essential was establishing it as a day of ceasefire and non-violence. The UN showed their support by sending a representative to the launch.
The Charter of the United Nations opens with three words: we the peoples. And I put it to you today that it is the peoples of this planet who can create peace.
There has never been a day in the history of humankind where the global community hasn't killed each other.
I personally wish the campaign every success in reaching out to people at every level and in achieving its ultimate goal, which is also what we at the United Nations aspire to most of all: peace one day.
I invited 2,500 people to the launch, mostly press. 114 people turned up, mostly friends. Nothing was written.
What was the first thing we were going to do?
Make peace for one day.
Make peace for one day.
Does anybody think that's possible?
This day will be useless, you know.
Who thinks it's not possible? Maybe you're right. Maybe it's not possible. Maybe it's idealism.
On the films they're actually making, are you going to show how people are dying? Or because then maybe people will take more serious notice of you.
The way I saw it, it was like I was in court. I was going to have to gather evidence for the day and present it to the member states of the UN to secure their vote in the General Assembly. To strengthen my case, I decided to visit areas of conflict, and my film camera would record the evidence. First stop was the UN office in Nairobi. They would arrange the safe passage to enter Somalia and Burundi.
Somalia is a complex place.
They would need security assistance.
It took 2 weeks of continuous meetings.
Since last year, things have just deteriorated all through this area.
We are talking about several levels of conflict and several areas of peace.
Camels and goats and death.
If you go in, you're going in a sense, with a UN hat on.
Yes.
Our auspices. If he feels that it's for any reason not safe, then that's the end of that story.
It was a hectic schedule of non-stop negotiation. I would have to wait for security clearance. The United Nations informed me about the Arusha peace talks in Tanzania, hosted by Nelson Mandela. I was told it was an opportunity, and I was going to take it.
Excuse me, there is a campaign.
No, I have finished it with the...
Okay.
He's leading a peace campaign.
A peace campaign?
Yeah, there's a campaign to create the first ever global ceasefire day in the history of humankind. Can Africa lead the world and make the rest of the people acknowledge a global ceasefire day?
That would be the least I can do, support, please.
Thank you, here's my card.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Je pense qu'il y a des représentants de l'OIE ici. S'ils acceptent cette idée, vous pouvez être assuré que le Burundi nous allons l'appuyer.
Most importantly, I was advised to meet the Secretary General of the Organization of African Unity, representing 53 African countries. Would he help?
The struggle for peace is a universal struggle. For Africa especially, it means a lot, because our continent has gone through a number of conflicts. The people who suffer mostly are innocent people, civilians, and especially women and children. You talk in terms of millions. So, yes, we welcome the idea of making a specific day as a day of peace, a day where there will be cessation of hostilities. As soon as you get a country,
yes,
which is ready to move forward,
yes,
then we'll be more than happy to try and work to get as many countries as possible to support that.
Fantastic.
Okay.
Well, I couldn't ask for more.
Thank you very much.
UN security clearance had been approved. I was on my way to Somalia to record testimonies of those forced to live in the aftermath of conflict. I arrived on a concrete airstrip in the middle of nowhere to be greeted by young men with machine guns. It was frightening.
Some were lying on the roads and were starving. Some of them, we found them
are sacking the breasts of your dead mothers.
The Belang and Jesus, they are okay, Kademese. Said the Gabriel, Ilam, Miguel, and Academia, and Chile, they are Rodaza, and all Lemigas, that Kungai go with them until they share it. And all your risk are. Are they okay, Kademese? Abu, they are Kademati. That's the one in Jesus, and they are.
How old is the young man? He is 16 years old. When did he start fighting?
96.
Yeah, in 1996 he started to fight.
When he was 12 years old?
Yeah.
What does he think about fighting now he's been here? Okay, has he ever killed anyone?
Will he offer the answer to that?
بالحقيقة قبل كفاي عاد يعاد يعتبرتين كديد ولا الشيخ هرتيه لك الدلاي فك الشيخ هرتيه لك الدلاي موت مركي امرارتون بندوقة تبديس لك دواي أدوني عيلشي عنا ماري واي دي داي قبرتاين هون دلني hortayna walaalshe intii roog in xabad la ku dhaw hortiis la ku kurkor oo nagay afartan jir ay hortay li ki dili iyo moodki hadii ana wariyalkii inta ka dhiyana ka sheekay ana er macna ma sheekay kor mana weedu kor ciilkii ay horyaal iyo cadaabti linig ay dhaafa ya qay dhaafa
Are there people dying because of no food?
Gaaji dartiye waakas May wal tas dheeri e kale ma jira may siinka mahad sadaane waana siinka mahad sadaane aduwiinaga ini dhibki unu nii moogada laka sheega yeda sa siinka mahad sadaane.
I started this journey thinking it didn't matter whether I succeeded in creating a day of peace. Filming the process was the important thing. I would have a film that would make a statement no matter what. But something happened to me in Somalia. Spending time with people who had suffered, who encouraged me to make the day a reality, changed everything. I knew at that point I didn't want to fail.
Si il arrive que cette journée soit acceptée, est-ce que vous ne voyez que parce qu'on remarque aussi des journées comme la journée de l'enfant africain par exemple, qui ne change rien sur la situation de l'enfant africain. Est-ce que vous ne voyez pas que cette journée sera comme d'autres journées qui n'ont rien en apport, qui n'apportent rien de positif?
So what do? We've got two choices. One choice is to say the days don't work, so forget about it. Let's just carry on.
Nous avons un choix. On va oublier, laisser tomber tout.
Or the second choice is that we, the young people, get together with other young people and say, no, we want a day of peace to work. We want a global ceasefire day. We might not get them to stop on that first, at the end of this first year. It might take 100 years. But if we save one life, then it would have been a worthwhile mission.
In order to change the existing UN resolution, I needed the support of two governments, one to sponsor and another to co-sponsor. The resolution could then be voted upon by all the governments represented at the UN. I wrote to Nobel Peace laureates asking if they'd help find sponsors. The first to come forward was former president of Costa Rica, Dr. Oscar Arias.
Vámonos!
had established the original day, it seemed to make sense they sponsor the new resolution. So whilst I was there, I contacted the president who created the original day in 1981, Don Rodrigo Carazo.
Our permanent commitment, above all, is to peace. May this peace day be indeed a day of peace. That's what was written, you know that. And it's not happening. Nobody knows about it.
Jeremy, let me interject, telling you the following. I could be in total agreement.
Yes.
That it could be a fixed day.
Yes, okay.
No problem. I would like to link it with the day in which the United Nations begin their meetings or their work in September every year.
But the thing is, the problem is that that's what's happened for 20 years and it hasn't worked.
Yes, of course. Yeah, well, the United Nations have been alive for 50 years and it hasn't worked.
I know, but it's the closest thing that we have.
Of course.
And so therefore you and I would agree that we have to do all we can to support it so that they get it right. I'm wondering if you would be willing to help me contact the Costa Rican government in order to ask them to put an amendment forward to the resolution so that the International Day of Peace gets given a fixed calendar day.
Yes, that would be easy. Who would refuse to do that? You know, the easiest thing would be for the two ambassadors to draft this at the UN.
You mean the Costa Rican ambassador in New York?
Yes.
And the Britain ambassador?
And the British.
Okay. Thank you very much. I mean, that's fantastic. You know what I want. I want to walk away with you saying, okay, Jeremy, let's put it forward and let's make sure at the beginning of the 21st century, everybody knows about it.
Yes. If this could be possible, it would be a great achievement.
It can be.
So go ahead and count on us.
They were willing to help change the resolution. It was the perfect start. I followed Dr. Oscar Arias's advice and wrote to the British government suggesting they might become the co-sponsor. As the world demonstrated it could come together in celebration, surely it could unite on a day of peace. What day would it be? Well, I thought the 21st of September as a mark of the 21st century. It was also the equinox and my granddad's favorite number.
I've just been to see Tony Brenton, who is the Director of Global Issues for the British Government, in relation to the amendment which he is now agreeing he will take forward. It doesn't mean it's a yes, and it certainly doesn't mean it's a no, but he's doing what I hoped he would do, which is take it forward to New York.
To meet the Costa Rican ambassador, I asked Oscar Arias and Don Rodrigo Carazo to help me get a meeting. They did.
Ambassador Niehaus, thank you so much
for
seeing me. So the first thing to say was that could Costa Rica put forward the amendment to the resolution in September of this year so that the United Nations International Day of Peace is given a fixed calendar date?
What we can do, what this mission, what Costa Rica can do to support this beautiful idea, we do it with pleasure. I have to contact my government, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, but I repeat, I am absolutely sure that in matter of peace, my government will support your idea and will give me the instructions in relation with this.
It was amazing. Ambassador Niehaus requested I put the idea in writing so he could pass the case on to his government. Within 2 days, the information was delivered to his office.
This is my suggestion. Yeah. When you go around the world and like find a group of people who like would do what you do, but in their country, then go to another country and do the same thing, so it'll make your thing more powerful.
Yeah. How old are you?
16.
So you're about to leave school soon?
Yeah.
Will you do it for me?
How was it all being paid for? It was difficult. Everything needed had to be given by someone.
We've got no money. BT have tried to cut us off this morning. So I'm just stalling them, saying that I'm going to send a cheque when I know that I haven't got the money.
Well, if you know anybody in your circle that's willing to cough up £100 so that they can help Peace One Day in some way.
Yeah, do we keep going with no telephones?
Yeah,
we do. We keep going with no telephones.
My mum gave me her spare bedroom to set up a production office. My dad helped me account for every penny I spent. Whenever I got on a plane, slept in a hotel, hired a car, I asked a corporation to support. Most of the time, they'd say yes. Friends volunteered to help. The cash I needed came from individual donations. People organized dinners and nights of theater in order to help pay the bills. The next meeting had taken months to plan, but I knew that every letter and phone call would be worth it.
Whether achieve within our lifetime or not. We are a human being. We have the responsibility to show right path, or at least make attempt for better future. Although we may not live, we may not enjoy that brighter future, but doesn't matter. This is the meant for humanity, meant for world. So no matter how limited the effect, we must make every effort, you see, for the promotion of peace and inner values. So I fully support.
With His Holiness the Dalai Lama's blessing and the Costa Rican ambassador moving the resolution forward, India and Sri Lanka became about learning what the practical effects of such a day might be.
If there is a cessation for a day, then it gives us an opportunity to move supplies safely through places that are otherwise difficult.
We would be ready to immunize children, raise awareness about the effects of armed conflict, and run whatever programs to help the children who are living in armed conflicts.
Okay, there will be a ceasefire day. How effective will it be globally?
Once it's established, through time, I think it will become more and more effective. What do you think?
To come to 100%, you need a lot of time.
Yes, yes.
And maybe our generation won't be there living when it comes to 100%. Maybe yes. We won't see that.
Yes.
But I think the great thing is at least we've done something for the next generation.
Yes.
So I think it's a good thing.
The case was growing stronger, but something began to concern me.
Hello, this is Jeremy Gilley, calling from India for Ambassador Niehaus.
Hello, this is Jeremy Gilley.
I kept trying to speak to Ambassador Niehaus. It had been almost 3 months since we'd met, and still no word. I wrote again, outlining the growing support and reiterating the urgency of the matter. I received a reply from the Costa Ricans. They were saying that fixing the date of the International Day of Peace and separating it from the opening of the General Assembly would change its raison d'etre. They wanted to consider it further. Costa Rica was still the strongest lead I had. For the next week, I put together a detailed case for fixing the date. As my letter to the Costa Rican ambassador made its way west across the Atlantic, I traveled east.
We begin our reports of the Middle East summit. The Israelis and the Palestinians persist, and they begin a 10th day of peace talks at Camp David.
רק תוכלי להסתכל בתמונות ולא להרגיש אותו מחבק אותך ומנשק אותך והוא לא יתחתן ולא יהיו לו ילדים. וזה הדבר שמאחד אותנו, גם עם המשפחות הפלסטיניות וגם עם המשפחות המצריות ומחר עם המשפחות הסוריות.
I'd arranged a meeting with Nobel Peace Laureate Shimon Peres, but on my arrival, he cancelled. I was also working hard to see Nobel Peace Laureate Yasser Arafat on his return from Camp David, but this was proving difficult as well. One of his ministers did agree to be filmed. I was not prepared for the depth of emotion that was all around me, but I was determined to listen and learn from both sides.
We've lived with conflict for so long that it's become part of personal experience.
Something big is going to happen. I don't know if it's going to be good or bad, because living on the edge cannot last for long.
I met Terje Rod Larsen, the United Nations key negotiator in the Middle East. This is a man who understands conflict, who spends his life trying to resolve it. I wanted to understand more about the nature of war and whether this day, in his eyes, had any serious value.
What you have to do when you have deep conflicts is to start with trying to persuade the two parties to talk to each other. Usually this takes a very long time. And it's necessary that it takes a long time because you, as a third party, have to gain the confidence of both parties.
Why have we not learned the lessons? Why does it continue? Why? When are we going to stop?
I think we have to, sadly, realize that there will always be conflict because of the differences of perception. That is, that we perceive the world differently. Then, secondly, the scarcity of resources. It can be land, it can be water, it can be oil, it can be food, it can be anything. This means that in all societies, and also in the global society, there is a need for a third party. And this is exactly the key role of the United Nations in the world. And I think the idea of having a sort of peace day as a practical aim, and I think also that it would carry the symbolism of peace in a very heavy way, I think it's a splendid idea and I would definitely support it.
Terje Rod Larsen reminded me of something I had read at the start of my journey, that the key to humanity's survival could be summed up in two words: intercultural cooperation. At a village where Arabs and Jews live together, I started to see how talking, even on a small scale, brings people closer together.
My best friend was killed by Israeli soldier when he go to school. How I can believe the peace is good?
My son was murdered by four Hamas terrorists. And I can tell you that I hoped that Mr. Arafat, Mr. Barak, will come back with an agreement.
He lost his son. And also your best friend was killed by an Israeli soldier. This is a reality. We can't ignore it.
We are speaking about very heavy feelings. The settlers are teaching every day to hate the Palestinians. The Palestinians, their education is also not to love the Jews. What will happen? You will have one day that maybe they will stop or speaking about friendship. It is not only to dance and to sing in that day. What we need to change the feelings.
What I saw gave me hope. But was it possible that someone who had seen fighting as their only option could consider dialogue as the way forward?
تخننتي لكاخد حمر نفس ولكنس لتوخ إسرائيل ولسيم حمر نفس شام كان كما على هرجتام شل شلوشت ها منهجين وكاخ عسيتي مي تكلا תקלת עבודה, התפוצץ המטען בתוך האוטו ואני נפצעתי. הייתי בבית הסוהר 21 שנה. וזה לא דבר פשוט, זה דבר מאוד נורא. למרות כל זה, אני מאמין בשלום. אני מאמין באנושות. אני מאמין שהאדם יש בו כוח עליון. אם הוא מנצל אותו לטובה, הוא יכול להגיע למרחקים גדולים מאוד. אם הוא מנצל אותם לדברים גרועים, הוא יכול לתת לאנושות לסבול. אני אישית ראיתי בעצמי כחייל בשבי שאין אף אחד בעולם שאוהב החירות ואוהב את השלום יותר מחייל בשבי. ואני לאחר שהשתחררתי, מיום הראשון שהשתחררתי אני השתתפתי בעשרות ובמאות פגישות עם ישראלים למען לתמוך בתהליך השלום, למען שהשלום הזה יחזיק מעמד. בשביל כך, המסקנה היחידה שהסכסוך הזה חייב להיוותר דרך תהליך פוליטי, תהליך של שלום, התבייסות, פשרה, ואני חושב שהדרך הזאת היא הדרך היחידה שיש לנו להמשיך לחיות כבני אדם בשני הצדדים.
After 3 weeks in the Middle East, my efforts to meet Shimon Peres finally paid off.
So peace is actually, if you want, the art of the continuation of our existence. Instead of filling our heads and memories with the past, let's teach our children to learn the history of the future.
So can I add you with Dr. Oscar Arias and the Dalai Lama as an endorsee of a global ceasefire day?
Yes. They are two friends of mine, and I appreciate very much what they are doing, and I shall gladly join them in. If you want 365, let's start with the first day.
בר דעת, אין לו שום ברירה אחרת אלא לתמוך ברעיון של הפסקת האש העולמית. ואני מנצל את ההזדמנות הזאת להקים תנועה עולמית למען השלום. ואני חושב שתנועה כזאת חייבת להיות הכי גדולה בעולם.
Peace means that I will take this weapon, throw it to the sea. And peace means that my children wouldn't even know what this is.
The headline, Mideast talks failed. A spokesman of the White House said the summit was ending without a deal.
I got back from the Middle East. There was still no response from my letter to the Costa Rican ambassador.
Hello, Ambassador Nijas? Yes, I'd like to leave a message.
The deadline for presenting the resolution to the General Assembly was weeks away.
So, the Ambassador Nijas is not there.
Time was running out and I was worried. I had two choices. I could either wait for Costa Rica or search for a different government. We contacted every head of state and every United Nations ambassador, urging them to take the resolution forward, and I looked to Ahmed Fawzi for guidance.
I wanted to let you know that I've done that. If there's anything else you think I could do.
No, you've done just about everything you can do, really.
The countries of the world would soon be gathering for the Olympics, and the international press were going to be there. I decided to hold a minute of silence on the UN's International Day of Peace, the third Tuesday in September. It was a perfect opportunity to get coverage. So when I arrived, I went straight to the UN, only to find out, once again, that the Day of Peace had already happened.
We have a situation where the first United Nations International Day of Peace of the 21st century, the most important day in the UN's calendar, is about 12 days away.
The 19th, for all practical purposes, for UN purposes, for the international community purposes, you know, was celebrated on the 5th.
But the world has been asked to celebrate it on the third Tuesday.
This year, for all practical purposes, International Day of Peace has been observed.
Yeah.
It has.
But by Kofi Annan and a few others, but not by the world. You know, we've not acknowledged it. We don't know about it.
He's the Secretary General of the United Nations.
But we don't know about it. Nobody knows about it.
Everybody knows.
I mean, if I did go out there now and ask 100 people, I'll bet you that almost 99% will not have even heard of the day and certainly won't know of Kofi Annan ringing a peace bell.
So what are you going to do?
Hopefully, you might be able to suggest something, or maybe we can talk to some of your friends. Or
the event that you are organizing is on the 19th.
Yes.
And so is the event that has been planned by the International Olympic Committee at the University of New South Wales. Why don't you attend and participate in this particular event?
Okay.
This was great news. We were going to mark the UN's International Day of Peace, and the president of the International Olympic Committee was going to be there. That meant press.
From time to time, you are approached by people
who may seem like a dreamer. Why? Because they look different, because they talk different, because what they say is sort of impossible to attain. But if we stop and think past that first impression and understand that it's good to be a dreamer, the next person is one of those, Jeremy.
We've communicated with every head of state, every United Nations ambassador, every Nobel Peace Laureate. We've worked with NGOs in and out of the field. We've visited schools. We've highlighted the predicament of women and children in areas of conflict. We've learned that a global ceasefire day is what they all want. The United Nations International Day of Peace is marked every year on the third Tuesday in September, which is today, by ringing the peace bell and holding a minute of silence. Could I please ask you all to pause for 1 minute, not just for those who will lose their lives today, but also to celebrate and bring peace to life.
The president of the IOC didn't attend, and nor did the press.
Thank you, Jeremy.
The 1 minute of silence was only held for 35 seconds. My big brother Nick was there. He lived in Australia. It had been a while.
How many seconds do you do? 35 seconds? Okay, then. Why don't we have 30 seconds of silence?
Whilst in Australia, I got news that governments were responding to the mail-out. Then I got a letter from the UK government.
Dear Jeremy, it seems most fitting for the Costa Rican government to take the lead on this resolution. We will certainly give positive consideration to co-sponsor when the resolution has taken shape in New York.
This is a famous victory, a magnificent performance.
But disaster was to follow.
6 months ago, I was told by the ambassador of Costa Rica, you know, Jeremy, I see no problems with this. I'm going to take it to my government. I see no reasons why Costa Rica won't go ahead with this amendment. We get a letter days ago from Costa Rica. We are not going to put that amendment forward at this year's General Assembly. That is our final position.
Not the outcome I'd hoped for. After all the work that had been done over the last 2 years, thousands of letters, hundreds of film meetings, and countless hours given by volunteers, it was a serious letdown. I was back to square one.
Look, I've seen so many miracles happen. I was told that the UN would not survive. It has survived, it is universal. I was told that decolonization would take 150 years. It was done in 40 years. I was told that the Cold War would never disappear. The Cold War has disappeared. I've seen so many miracles in my life that I believe in miracles and dreams, because someone, somewhere, has to come up with the first dream.
I needed some advice. I arranged another meeting with Tony Brenton at the Foreign and Commonwealth Office. He told me to cease dialogue with the Costa Rican mission in New York, supply him with all the correspondence, and then let his department communicate with the Costa Ricans on our behalf. I was worried it would all collapse.
Keep trying. Keep trying.
That's it. That's all it's about, isn't it?
Christmas came and went that year, and brought with it a sign that a day of peace could be used by everyone, not just people with guns. After my parents' divorce, their relationship had all but collapsed. Now, 30 years later, they were jiving together as friends. At the beginning of 2001, there was no news from the Foreign and Commonwealth Office. I was on the verge of packing it in. Part of me just wanted to stop now and create a film about failing. That would be my statement. Global unity, intercultural cooperation, not right now. Then I got a phone call from the office of the Secretary General.
To be able to meet Kofi Annan, we will do anything at any point, you know, really incredibly flexible and totally want to work with his schedule since it's a lot busier than mine.
If I was going to carry on, the strategy had to be different. I was going to be in offices, not conflict zones. I wanted to meet Kofi Annan and fit in straight away. The ponytail had to go.
So we're probably 2 or 3 minutes.
No problem, sir. Sorry, I'm just sitting.
Secretary General, do you support the creation of the first global ceasefire day in the history of humankind?
Oh, absolutely. I think it's a great idea. Any moment, whether it's a day or a week, that we can give the combatants to pause, to think, and reflect on what they are doing to their own people and to their environment will be a great achievement, and I would support it 100%.
Once established,
mm-hmm.
Will you bring the active and practical support of the United Nations to the Global Ceasefire Day to promote its full observance?
We have troops all around the world trying to resolve these conflicts. And so this is something that will be beneficial to my troops on the ground and to the operations we are engaged in. So I will support it, and I'm sure the member states will understand the need for this sort of initiative, and I wish you all the best, and I think you should continue. Individuals can make a difference, and if each of us did our bit, collectively we'll make a major contribution.
Many thanks.
Good.
He said things I really didn't expect him to say. I was looking at him thinking, we must be really close now. Because, you know, if you're an advisor to Kofi Annan, why would you advise him to talk to me and say the incredible things he said on film if the UN system didn't believe there was any chance of the day becoming a reality?
Well done, man. That was great, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I contacted the British government, outlining Kofi Annan's 100% support. A few weeks later, a letter came through from the Prime Minister, Tony Blair, requesting I meet John Battle, the MP responsible for UN issues. It was the first time I'd been given a meeting with a Minister of State.
Thank you very much. You looked underneath the bonnet, you said, I can't believe you got here. The Undersecretary General for Political Affairs, Kieran Prendergast, said to me, Jeremy, go back, go to England, get their support and create a new resolution.
Yeah, because I can't give you a commitment here and now to say that we're going to support a resolution and do a certain way.
Okay.
Is that what you wanted?
Well, I mean, I'm...
I'll just call the interview off if that's what you wanted, because there's no way I can give you that kind of commitment. Because I don't know what the conversation is in the background. I've not been briefed on Stuart Eldon overnight.
Okay. Well, I mean, I was going to... I'm going to get to that, but I'm not going to... You know, it's... If you don't... I understand the situation is that...
You can't get you lot there, me sat behind a chair and say to me, well, I support that. You'll get vague noises about we'll be warm about it, but there's no way I can commit ourselves to resolutions. Resolutions have to be worked through. You've got to build support from...
No, I understand. No, I understand that But I don't know how well you've been briefed, Mr. Battle, so there might be in a situation where you were here today to say, Jeremy, guess what? You know, we can do this. But I mean,
I'm not on running on a film, I'm not. We could have had the conversation before, but running on a camera, that's not a way to do it.
Yeah. No, and I understand that it takes time. I mean, what I've done is I've always filmed the journey of creating a global ceasefire day, and I understand that you don't need to make a clear commitment here today, that it's a process, and it's a process that takes time, and one that, you know, we respect. Yeah. And very patient.
Otherwise, it won't happen. You need to be patient with the process, or it won't happen.
Absolutely.
And we need to be patient with the process as well, because unless you get support, it won't happen.
Yes.
Putting resolutions together in the UN is the hardest thing in the world.
Yes.
To get the commitment of others to do it.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So I think that perhaps.
But in principle, there's no opposition to it.
Okay.
What you're trying to do is focus it. But if you're saying to me, put a gun to your head, to use a metaphor, can you give me a resolution and say you're going to go for a new resolution? The answer now is no.
Right.
Because we've got to work through the process of it.
Yes.
And we'll do that. But we're willing and positive about working through the process of it. I think Tony Brenton's words were, what was it, positive consideration.
That's correct.
But that's a bit more active in my mind than just positive consideration. We'll look at it. I'm actually wanting to make it happen.
If we can work together to make this happen at this year's General Assembly.
I'll have conversations from here with Tony Brenton and with our guy in New York and see what we can do practically now.
Okay. Good. Well, Mr. Battle, I didn't... Thanks very much.
Yeah.
Very kind
All
of you.
All the best with it as well.
Minister Battle wanted to help, but he only had a few months to table the resolution if it was going to be voted on at this year's General Assembly. I had to get more influential people on side.
My experience of conflict is that those who are involved in it, and unfortunately in my work I see a great deal of this, long for even a day of peace. That's what they say to me. If this would only stop for a day, it has the practical impact of allowing access of humanitarian aid, access of information, freedom of movement, relief from the pressure and tension of not knowing where the next bomb or bullet may come from. That to me is an idea whose time has come.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mary.
I still needed a sponsor to table the resolution, and the money was running out. It was getting more and more difficult to keep going. I was introduced to the boss of a firm of city traders in the East End of London. He wanted to help, offering office space, phones, cash flow. It was amazing. The name of the firm, ironically, Execution.
There's so many organisations to involve, to enrol, to get support from. I mean, it's a never-ending process.
UNICEF and others, but UNICEF in particular, for example, to reach children with...
Try and get a broader peace so that the potential lives saved are not just the lives that might have been lost on the day itself, but the lives which are saved by...
Just have to keep on asking.
The sin for those who may not have joined in on that first day of peace.
And what we're saying is we don't want to continue down this road, because if we do, we're going to destroy each other.
The deadline for putting forward the resolution was now weeks away. I could only think of one more thing to do. I produced a promotional film presenting the case. I hoped it would inspire the leading characters, since they were all in it, to help. I sent it to every head of state, all UN ambassadors, all Nobel Peace laureates, my contacts at the UN, humanitarian organisations, corporate sponsors, all schools I had visited, in fact, everyone I had met so far. Creating the short film worked. On July the 12th, His Holiness the Dalai Lama wrote to 11 heads of state. His letter read as follows.
Your Excellency, please find enclosed here a document explaining the efforts of Peace One Day in creating a United Nations Global Ceasefire Day and to raise global awareness about such a day. The UN Secretary General, Mr. Kofi Annan, Mr. Shimon Peres, and others have supported this effort. I have also given my full support. I am writing this in the hope that you may find merit in the proposal of Peace One Day and support it. I understand from Mr. Jeremy Gilley, founder Peace One Day, that a copy of a promotional film of this project has been sent to you. With prayers and good wishes, yours sincerely, His Holiness the Dalai Lama.
Suddenly I got a phone call from the UK Foreign and Commonwealth Office.
Hi, Jeremy. There has been a bit of progress recently in New York on trying to get the draft resolution together, and the Costa Ricans said that they were looking to co-sponsor it. Don't want to get your hopes up unduly, but just trying to let you know that the Costa Ricans are
The UK government were turning it around. They invited me to New York. It was now in the hands of the leaders of our world. Would they vote for the day?
Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to start.
The 7th of September, 2001. The session of the General Assembly has just started. And I'm here in a booth waiting for the United Kingdom to establish the first ever global ceasefire day. Fingers crossed.
Now I give the floor to the representative of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland to introduce draft resolution A55L95.
Mr. President, the United Kingdom and Costa Rican governments have now joined together to strengthen and reinvigorate what we believe is a unique and still largely unfulfilled opportunity for the practical furtherance of peace. The need for such an enhanced approach was originally brought to our attention by a UK-based organisation, Peace One Day.
Señor Presidente, desde que el ser humano cruzó el umbral de la historia, la humanidad ha vivido bajo la sombra de la guerra, la destrucción y la muerte. La humanidad debe tomar las riendas de su destino y guiar con mano firme sus pasos hacia un futuro mejor.
This draft resolution recommends that henceforth the UN International Day of Peace be observed as a global ceasefire day. It further recommends that the UN International Day of Peace becomes a fixed date in the calendar to avoid the confusion that has arisen in recent years as to when the day falls. The draft suggests that this day be fixed as the 21st of September.
Esperamos que esta resolución será adoptada con el firme respaldo de todos los Estados miembros. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Mr. President.
May I take it that the Assembly decides to adopt draft resolution? It is so decided.
No, you know those things that you have in court that you whack? They whack one of them.
Dream come true. On the morning of September the 11th, 2001, the last International Day of Peace before the new resolution came into effect, Kofi Annan was going to ring the peace bell and announce the changes for the following year in front of the world's press.
Both buildings have exploded, and it looks as if
Two planes have hit the World Trade Center, and Kofi Annan is just about to ring the peace bell. And there could well have been a terrorist attack, you know, in New York. And I'm standing here right beside the UN, very tall building, the headquarters of the United Nations, and, you know, some people are suggesting that this would be the second place to be attacked, so it feels very strange to have witnessed the explosions on the World Trade Center and now be here. A little band behind. I don't know, it's just weird, isn't it? It's a very strange moment.
Now, this is just to inform you that on the recommendation of the Chief of Security, we have been asked to postpone this event. Now, my understanding is we should all move out of here and head towards the visitors' entrance and outside. Thank you very much.
It's just total mayhem. This is incredibly frightening. Will you ring my mum and just tell her I'm fine? They've evacuated the United Nations and the proceeds have been stopped. You know about the Pentagon, right? There's a bomb by the White House.
You gotta get off the corner!
Well, I'm standing beside the UN. I mean, I'm beside it right now. It's unbelievable, isn't it? It's just the most awful thing.
Just keep on going on and on and on.
We have to change our consciousness. So maybe the pain and the trauma and the horror that we felt on this land will make the people who are making decisions that affect the small people, the little people, the working hard class people trying to make a dollar out of 15 cents, those people, maybe there'll be some more compassion. Maybe they'll think about future generations. Maybe it won't be living in the moment, getting your money, greed, conquer, destroy, and kill for a dollar.
It's the 12th of September today. Right behind us is where the World Trade Centers used to be. We've been advised to wear, you know, this stuff because the asbestos in the air, you know, the smell down here of burning is really really intense. You know, it's interesting seeing Bush and the words that he's using. Feels to me like, you know, we're about to break into a serious war. But I think, you know, for us, for our film, for what we were trying to do, I think it makes it all the more poignant. You know, that peace one day, perhaps, in establishing a global ceasefire day only 3 days ago, can, for families and teachers, you know, offer up a little bit of light in the situation. You know, it's a mad time.
Deliberate and deadly attacks, which were carried out against our country, were more than acts of terror. They were acts of war. The American people need to know we're facing a different enemy than we've ever faced.
It was difficult to know what to do now. One thing was certain, I didn't want to stop here. Would the day work? That was the real test. I had to find a way to tell as many people as possible, in a climate of war and terror, that there was now a day of peace. On the 21st of September, I invited the international press to a 365-day countdown to the first ceasefire day. One television crew turned up.
An East London filmmaker is celebrating after the United Nations backed his plans for an international day of peace, Damon Green reports.
Their project is to organise a global ceasefire in all conflicts on this day next year, and they say it's not just a daydream. Its job now to convince the people doing the fighting.
We had to inform everyone, from governments to individuals, that the day existed, asking them to mark it in whatever way they could. You can only ask, and that process would have to continue right up to the 21st of September. In terms of actual ceasefires, I wasn't going to pretend that I had conflict prevention skills. That had to be handled by organisations with expertise, like the UN and key non-governmental organisations. They were all asked.
Today, you know, from my point of view, it was to say, OK, the day's been created, a resolution's been established. In a way, I'm in your hands.
We've created this situation. What's the outcome going to be? There's good time. We have good time on our side. What can we achieve? What inspirational message can the United Nations send to the people in the world on the first time it's created a global ceasefire day? You all know much better than me what is achievable, and if we can make that a reality, then I think there's something ever so special for the global community.
Thank you, Jeremy. I think you've given everyone something to think about. We will have to coordinate our efforts, and we'll see where we go from there.
That was the end of a long year, and I'd met a girl in New York. We decided to spend New Year together. It was a chance to stop, recharge the batteries, and just drive.
Of September this year in some way.
The challenge is to all those named in the resolution, effectively everyone.
You can only reach so many people by speaking, writing and meeting. I decided to hold a formal press event in the hope it would generate the exposure the day needed. People were willing to take part, including one of the most important men in the Arab world.
Well, it's the 12th of March, 2002, and today I met the Secretary General of the League of Arab States, Amr Moussa. He invited me to film a statement for our press conference, and obviously I had to come out here and record that. So I was thinking as I was watching him and how he was kind of like really free-flowing with it, that there was most definitely an opportunity to push further, and I asked the question to say, look, you know, if you support it, can we create a mechanism which creates a kind of framework, if you like, for that support carrying itself out?
Well, we can call for a meeting of the representatives of all member states to observe this day and to prepare for a wide campaign throughout the Arab world.
How far in advance, before the ceasefire day, do you think it would be useful? And we would, of course, love to bring the cameras to document very important meeting.
Right, we can do that a month.
One month
in advance.
I applaud your commitment. I think it's incredibly inspirational.
I'm with you. I'm with you. Whenever it comes to the establishment of peace, and I'm on board.
21st of August. I will very much look forward to meeting you again.
You have a deal on this. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. What an honor.
Thank you.
We need use of force to come to a full stop at a certain moment so that talks.
We therefore pledge to work towards achieving the aims and objectives envisaged for the Global Ceasefire Day.
It is our intention to tell the peoples of the world about the day.
I don't know what impact it will have. I simply cannot stand still and watch.
This step can be more than symbolic. Where respected, it can have practical effect.
No press turned up. It amazed me that the leaders of our world could create the first ever UN Global Ceasefire Non-Violence Day, and that nobody wanted to write about it, particularly in light of the conflicts going on all around us. If I was about to record not only the day's creation, but also its failure, that would be the film. Thing is, I didn't want to make that film. I decided to go back to New York one last time. There were 2 months until the ceasefire day, and I wanted to see how the United Nations was getting on.
It's going well, you know.
It's interesting.
You're a visionary, not a fool.
There is.
That's finally demonstrated.
Well, I think that what I want to say to you today is we came to the United Nations because this was the closest thing that we have to holding the global community together. And that resolution clearly states that the governments and the UN system, you know, are being asked to commemorate in an appropriate manner a ceasefire and non-violence. Yeah. But if the very people that it's aimed at don't act themselves as well on some level, then we've got a big question suddenly just really attack
me
head.
Government, democratic governments take account of popular opinion. You need to work directly on governments, but you also need to influence governments through civil society. They don't take so much notice of what the UN Secretariat tells them. But I think that your role, actually, which is a very valuable one, is as a catalyst, you know, as a ginger group. And, you know, you carried this ball, and I think you should carry on carrying it, because you're doing it very well.
I respected Kieran. He was right. It was also up to the people to make this day work. But people can't act if they don't know about it, and the media hadn't helped. We needed a big event and celebrities. The experts were saying, organise a concert. So it was decided that the venue would be Brixton Academy in London. We had a few weeks in which to persuade a high-profile lineup to play for free and to sell 5,000 tickets. Amre Moussa had been true to his word and invited me to make a presentation to the League of Arab States, 22 countries from the Arab world. If I could get them to make a public statement that they would observe the day, what a sign it would be. My strategy was always the same. Show them the short film and then ask for what I wanted.
And if we could press play.
I had no idea of the effect the film would have.
To have a day of cessation of violence, of ceasefire, of rejection of deadly conflict, that to me is an idea whose time has come.
Peace is actually, if you want, the out of the continuation of our existence. If you want 365, let's start with the first day.
I think it's a great idea.
It is.
I didn't think to edit Shimon Peres out of the film.
The representative of Palestine wishes to take the floor, please.
وأن نرى صورة السيد بيريز الذي يشارك في قتل الأطفال يوميا في فلسطين هذا انحياز من هذا الفيلم إلى العدو الإسرائيلي لم نرى إشارة واحدة على طفل فلسطيني قتل على حاجز أو دمرت مدرسة فلسطينية لم نرى عدلا في هذا الفيلم يا معالي الأمين العام ونحن لا نريد أحد يأتينا من الخارج ليضع لنا برنامج عمل كيف نعمل من أجل السلام لذلك للسيد المبجل ونحن نرحب به هنا وفق الضيافة العربية نقول له برجاء تغيير هذا الفيلم حتى يكون متوازن مع قرارات ومبادئ الأمم المتحدة التي نلتف حولها وتدعونا أنت لنلتف حولها.
So I add my voice to what my colleague from Palestine had mentioned. I think the film is unjust. I think the Israeli government should be fully aware that there is at least one day, not around the clock, killing people. So I think you are preaching to the converted and you should go and preach to them.
Can I?
Yes, please.
Thank you for sharing your thoughts. And I agree with many of the thoughts that you have. I visited Gaza, I visited the West Bank, I saw Shimon Peres because I asked all Nobel laureates for a statement about peace. Peace One Day is not saying who is right and who is wrong. In our hearts, we know if someone dies, it is wrong. The Arab League has an incredible opportunity to demonstrate to the world its commitment to peace by calling for ceasefire and non-violence on the first ever UN ceasefire day. I honestly come here for you to make history. I ask you to lead the world and I will document that journey. I thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. It's a pleasure, thank you so much.
I am so sorry, I am deeply disappointed. Deeply disappointed. You give us the picture of Shimon Peres. I hope that with Peres you put Arafat.
I asked to see Arafat. Worked ever so hard to see Arafat.
Everybody.
He couldn't see me.
No, he will see you immediately.
I'm ready to come.
anytime.
But do you understand the opportunity?
I am working in this political field for 40 years. This is politics.
Yes, do you understand the opportunity that you have, though, and the Arab League has? Because the Arabs want...
I did not see one single picture about the Arab world. None.
Secretary General Amr Moussa is in the film.
Only the
But he was the only one. He was the only one who was seen.
No, Amr Moussa is not the suffering of the children of Palestine, of Iraq, of Sudan, etc., etc. So, I hope you will see Arafat soon.
Well, can I have your card? And I will write to you. Yes. I'm ready to see Mr. Arafat. I want him in the film.
I'd made a serious mistake. I kept thinking about this phrase, intercultural cooperation. It sounded easy, but it's difficult to pull off. I didn't hear back from the Palestinian ambassador, but at least we had spoken our minds, and I respected him and the Arab League for the access I'd been given. No sooner had I got back, I received a letter concerning the Brixton event that I wasn't expecting.
Dear Jeremy, Monday's sales were 255 for Brixton, and I have to advise you that you desperately need to move venue. I would predict that you will get an attendance of 1,000 people, which will leave you with a huge cash shortfall. In addition to this, the venue will be totally empty and the atmosphere of the event totally destroyed. You will not sell another 4,000 tickets in the next 2 weeks. These sort of miracles are not a reality. You need to look at moving this to a more financially viable venue. The sooner this decision is made, the better it will be for all parties concerned. Best regards, Bob. So, I mean, has anyone got any strong views about leaving Brixton?
I think we put all our energy into informing everybody that there's been a change of venue, when we could be putting our energy into contacting our networks, pushing it hard.
Some people may turn up on the night. It is a risk.
I mean, my feeling is the same as everyone's, is that, you know, that we don't cancel it.
It was make or break. Everyone did everything they could, including Dave Stewart and Jimmy Cliff. At a press conference, they announced they'd written a song and were going to play live at the event. With celebrity backing, the press were finally getting interested.
Dave Stewart's joined the call.
A day where people think about
next
world peace.
From war talk to peace.
The
talk.
Sanctions as a result give a little bit of.
But the people who are watching your show now know.
I'd love Londoners to come.
It is a marvellous idea, this whole piece.
It's quite mind blowing that it's never been done before.
It is possible.
What is.
What will you be doing?
What will you be doing?
Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much.
There was nothing more we could do.
Can make a difference, and if each of us did our bit, collectively we'll make a major contribution.
Thank you to the United Nations who have listened to an individual. I am incredibly grateful, and thank you most importantly, quite seriously, to all of you. There's 4,500 people in this room, and I really, really thank you, because it's up to us. The individuals do this. Come on! Yes! It's you! Come on!
On the 21st of September 2002, activities took place in 98 countries, 27 from governments, 33 from the United Nations system, 176 from non-governmental organizations, 180 from religious and spiritual groups, 71 from youth organizations, and from countless individuals. Everyone was asked to record and send their images in. Many did. With all the press coverage, an estimated 240 million people became aware of the day.
Tonight is a very special night. You are all part of history. But I can hear these skeptics out there saying, will governments uphold this resolution? I'll tell you what they'll do. They will listen to the voices of the people. Your voices. So if we can galvanize the voices of the people all over the world, we can do it. And your voices will be heard.
No ceasefires were negotiated for the day, but the United Nations did act. 33 separate initiatives.
This year begins a new Peace Day tradition. The General Assembly decided that from now on, the International Day of Peace will be observed every year on 21st September as a day of global ceasefire and non-violence.
In Ethiopia and Eritrea, after 23 years of war and only 27 months of ceasefire, the UN held events in both countries, using the day to strengthen the fragile peace between them.
Our actions today will shape the world in which our children are going to live.
They say enough with conflict and start to work for development. Our demand should be peace, not war.
And from civil society in the Ohafia region of Abia State in Nigeria, an entire community declared peace after 12 years of violence, hatred, and destruction.
My dear people and my friends, we have also seen the full harvest of hatred and destruction because peace and unity unites us. The entire world is marking the World Peace Day. We have to address peace now.
And then we did it all again in 2003 and got the message to even more people, 610 million. Face you see now, there are thousands who weren't. Not only those who acted on the day, but also the men and women behind the scenes who made the resolution a reality. Individuals in the United Nations, at the UK and Costa Rican governments worked it out. They gave us our day. They need to know they started something, that they got it right. Awareness is great, but I'm not aware of one ceasefire happening, although I've asked, and I wanted to know if you could, like, tell me why that is.
It's not easy to answer the question. Governments have adopted the resolution adopting the 21st of September as International Day of Peace, but to them, I think it's more of an abstract goodwill celebration. Let's have a concert, let's love each other and hug each other. But how far can we go to silence the guns? That's the big question.
So if the people were to unite on the 21st of September, each year, growing and growing, that could actually make government honor the day of peace that they unanimously adopted. I mean, do you think that?
I think it's important that people know there are other ways to resolve conflict other than taking up arms. I know cynicism sets in and we're disillusioned because resolutions aren't implemented, but eventually the forces of peace are stronger than the forces of evil. And eventually, one day, people will come to realize that it is their future that's at stake.
that if they sit in their armchairs complacently and expect peace to come to them, then they're mistaken, because it won't. They have to get up and say, we want peace. Stop it. But it's an ongoing, it's not one film, Jeremy. But we have to start somewhere. It's dozens of films and dozens of books and dozens of lectures and hundreds of demonstrations that will finally change the culture from a culture of war into a culture of peace.
Listen, man, thanks for all your words over the years, you know.
Thanks. Thanks for your support. Good luck with everything.
Yeah. Cool. That's it, man.
So many broken hearts, tell me when will it mend? And it's a trend that we gotta break. If we could stop being fake, yeah. Look at where we're going, look at what is at stake. Examine the cause, examine the effect. When there is no justice, tell me what do you expect? Let's genuflect and show respect to every class, color and creed. And let's keep in check, don't get entangled in the selfish wreck. Look what you give is what you get.